sitting in the corner. I hope you're going to join us after you get your food. My name is Oreoluwa, Lesi, and I'm the founder and executive director of W.TEC. That's the Women's Technology Empowerment Center, a nonprofit organization based in Lagos. And what we do is we empower women and girls through access, training, mentoring, and research and information technology. Our work aims to close the gender digital divide. So to get more women into technology, working in technology and using technology in their work and in their lives. So this is an aspect of, it's something that we haven't really explored because we always focus on the children. So this is the first time that we decided to look from a different perspective, the perspective of the parents. So we're going to have what I'm sure will be a very interesting discussion. And we have four incredible speakers who are going to share their experiences and strategies. They're all parents. They all have some varying degrees of experience with technology, using technology. Some are hardcore techies and some are not. So we're going to be hearing about their experiences and how they're able to cope and keep up with their children in this new era where technology moves, basically. So to get us started, I'll start by calling up my speakers. We have Dr. Oluwakemi, and she is the CEO of Executive Educational Technologies, and she's also a lecturer at the Olabisi-Orobanjo University in Ogun State. She has a PhD in Educational Technology. Thank you, Kemi. Then we have Ms. Yeti Williams. She's the founder and CEO of Lagos Moms. How many of us know Lagos Moms? Yes. So she promotes healthy parenting, and she does that online and also by organizing events. So she's also here to share her experience with us. We have Mrs. Terae, Onyeje. She is now the CEO of KraveX Limited, and she'll tell us a bit about what she does, but she is a hardcore techie woman. Before she, while she was running KraveX, she was also channel sales director of Lenovo Technologies, and before that, HP. So welcome, Terae. And we have our lone gentleman on the panel. We invited him because he's an incredible speaker and he has a lot to share. He's an educational HR and leadership consultant, and he's also going to be sharing, drawing from his work and also his experience as being a parent. So please welcome Mr. Yomi Fawehinmi on the stage. Also popularly known as Prof, so I'm calling him Prof. All right, so to get things started, we'll just do a go round, and I'd like to hear from each one of you about your children, what kind of technologies your children use on a daily basis. So maybe you can start with its needs and then move down. Yes.
Good afternoon, everybody. I think the top technology my children use is Google. Can't get away from Google. Everything they do is a Google search away. From school, they have to use computers from year 3, primary 3. So by default, they're exposed to technology on a daily basis to do research and homework and all of that.
We have different devices. We have the external quick lights. We have a dedicated laptop to them for their research from school, and then and they love the smartphones, because especially their dads, because of the games he has on them. So those are the three major technologies they use at home.
Okay, can you tell us what it's something like is for people who don't know?
Well, it's a tablet that was made for students for different grades, so you have access to free networks, educational network sites, you can access them free. They have a package for the data also for them and all that. They have a lot of educational content on the tablets.
I'm a bad mom who moves her children into technology, so I've used technology for all the right reasons and all the wrong reasons. So what do they use? They use everything. I've been in technology for 23 years and my husband's in technology. So name it, it will be in my house. So my home is the type of home where kids come and kids don't want to go because we use it for education and for entertainment. So essentially, name it, it will be in my house. Okay, great. We'll get into that
a bit
more
later. Good afternoon, everybody. My children use technology for an array of purposes, education, entertainment. Interestingly, I came with my son, so he's going to endorse or review whatever I say. So he's much more into tech, he's into photography, he's into using all the tools online to improve his work. Because of his age now, he's also on social media, so he uses all the social networking sites and also the tools and things. So the array of available opportunities technology offers, they use most of them.
Okay, so it seems that all your children use technology on a daily basis. Was there a particular time when you realized that, they're telling me something, they're telling me they're doing something, or they're using a tool, but I don't understand, I don't know what the child is talking about. Was there such a moment for you? Yes.
So I would say that, it wasn't necessarily that they said something that I didn't understand. What I think surprised me was when my son at 5, he asked me a question and I said, I don't know. He said, how can you say you don't know? Just Google it. And I think that was the first time I realized that in their world, they don't understand how there's always an answer and that answer is not far away. I actually call him Uncle Google because he has moved in and I don't know, doesn't exist again in our house. Everything is Google it. So I think that was probably the first time I realized that, wow, these children have access to all kinds of information. And parenting is even more challenging now because we have these external influences that we can't control 100%.
What about you, Kemi? I don't know what your first degree is in, but you have a PhD in educational technology. And I met you at a techie conference, and that's what I know that you do. So did you have such an experience, or were you always like several steps ahead of your children?
Well, maybe for content, maybe you can get several steps, but like I was telling someone recently, connections, all those joining wires. You know, because all the time my husband got a device that connected all the devices into one place and then you had to switch things. Till this, I don't go there. So I just called one of them, I want to do this. So like, for that, I think they're way ahead of me in that area.
Terae, what about you?
I would have seen that as well. When it comes to connections, when they move things around, I can't figure it out. But the place where I thought technology was getting me a little crazy and the new social media platforms, I still don't get the reason for Snapchat. I mean, 1 minute is there, next minute is gone. Why? You know, and my daughter loves Snapchat. I mean, you see her finger on the phone just going and thinking, why do you have to like so many pictures? Why do you have to make it safe on everything you see? And she just smiles. I honestly don't understand Snapchat.
What about you?
I think my own is a bit slightly different. It's from the issues around when do you allow your child to go to social media. You know, there's a sense in which you feel that you are supposed to give them a license, like you give them a license to drive and all of that. And I had some experiences where I realized that I had to deal with my own children having to go on social media before the time I thought they should go on social media. And we had a lot of issues around that. One advice I also give to parents is that in that regard, I think one thing I could have done differently, looking back, is the fact that once a child presses social media, you may not be able to get him out of it. You may think you have, but you have not. So the most likely thing you likely had that they shut an account, they opened an account that you did not know existed. So that was one thing for me. But again, for us, for the two, then one aha moment was when my son now became older and realized the value of we knowing ourselves on social media. And so he sends out a tweet and tags me now. You know, and then so he tagged me on the tweet. So he did a very beautiful piece of art and tagged me on it. So I retweeted it and quoted it and said, oh, this is what my son did. And all my friends started retweeting it. And he saw one very big person that said, I saw your work. And he was like, how did you see my work? Your dad tweeted it. So now it's gone from a fight over go to social media to become a partnership. I help him, he helps me, and so I think those initial fights we always have, but I think over time, most of you maintain your sense of balance and wisdom at the end of the day, and you remember you had a parent when you had a daughter. So that for me was an issue.
Okay, so you are active on social media, you are active on Twitter, Twitter and Facebook, that I know. Now you spoke about when they actually get started on social media. For a lot of the social networking sites, there's a minimum age of 13. And I know children who are younger than that who are on these social media sites. Now, as you mean, you don't even know what they're doing, how can you now regulate and say, oh, you shouldn't be on Facebook because the minimum age is 13? I don't know how old your son was when you went online, or you know, the rest of your children, but was that an issue that you knew that, or you knew that there was a minimum age and you're younger than the minimum age, so you shouldn't be on there?
That's what we're dealing with about the question of trying to deal with the minimum wage. So the owners of those platforms created their minimum wage, but I am a parent. I can also determine my own minimum wage. And that was what we're dealing with, not the minimum of 13. That's what we're dealing with. But again, one of the things I come to realize is that I think any parent in today's world needs to be aware, to be there. I mean, you just can't negotiate it. I had a very interesting experience when my younger son needed to get information from his friend. And I was able to reach him, and he just said, I remember his dad's tutor, Andrew. Why don't you send a direct message to his dad? Let his dad ask him the question, and he'll snap the documents to you, and then you download it for me. And I was like, so easy. I mean, this was something we needed. It was a Friday. Because we didn't know their house, we didn't have their phone number, we would have had to pay some money. And he just gave me the option of go to Twitter, send a direct message to them, let them snap it and send it to me. And I was like, I mean, so sometimes, I think we need to agree that before those ages, they may have a need for it, but it's for us to create that connection with them that they can come to us to tell us this is what they want to do. And then some of us can agree how it should be done. Oh, okay, use my Twitter and to do it, or use your mom's and do that as a Facebook. But I think we should not just align with the age given by Twitter or Snapchat as a Facebook. You are the parents and you make the rules and you enforce them.
So what was the age, minimum age that you gave your children so they could actually be active?
I can't really remember. Precious, do you remember? I think it's 15 or 16, 15 or something like that. I can't really remember. 15 or 16. I think it's 15 or something like that.
Terry, did you want to add
to that? My daughter got the night she was 13, she got up.
The night she was 13.
We've been waiting for that 13, so that night she was up. Now, what is interesting is, because we set it up for her, I was on her page. I probably lasted 2 years on that page, and then she quietly unfriended me. I'm sure there are a few people in the audience that have had that experience. What was my crime? I was too vocal. So I agree with you. You need to be involved. You need to be very involved. But you need to use wisdom. So I'm not very much immersed in all of what she does, but I never talk about it directly. I create hypothetical situations where we have nice discussions. Because when I have access to that page, I am seeing the teenagers that are going around half naked. I'm seeing the careless conversations that are being had. But you know, when you talk about it, then they get defensive. But I need to know so that I can address it in a way that the best benefit my child. Okay, so I'm not sure how other moms will deal with it. What I see with a lot of moms is they throw their hands up in the air and they don't seem to have an understanding of technology. But I also say to them,
if you're going to give your child nutritious meals, look at technology as nutrition as well. You need to be in there to make sure that the child is getting what is good for the child. Or you'd wake up one day and you'd be wondering, what on earth happened?
So it seems like technology has, by and large, your focus is really on parenting, good parenting, and the technology is like an extension to that. It reflects the way you parent. Yeah. Okay. Now, so Kemi, you teach young people and older people, you know, how to use technology, and you're a specialist in educational technology. Now, what kinds of tools? Because I know that a lot of children have smartphones these days. You know, a lot of children play games, and a lot of parents complain that, oh, my child is just wasting their time online. I don't know what they're doing, but you know, they're just playing video games or whatever. You know, they always categorize it as playing video games. Now, have you been able to use your own expertise to introduce your children to specific tools that you feel are educational, edifying, contribute to learning, their growth?
Yeah, yes. I for one, I'm not a game person. But then I know for instance, my husband likes sometimes to see play games. So my kids don't normally come to my device and they find games. But I decided, okay, there are a lot of games that teach them skills. I realized I have a son who was struggling at the time with maths. And the truth is that there's so much resources out there online that people have freely given us to assist our kids learning. I've seen it help my daughter learn spellings, because you know, you're like, the word is pronounced, the letters are sounded and all that. You want to play a game. I'm against just playing game. My parents complain they're just wasting time. So if I find a game, it's a game, it's fun, but it's actually teaching a particular concept or a particular subject, a topic or something like this. So they're having fun while they're learning. That's my drive. So I take time, I sit online, I browse through those applications or those resources, and then I lead them. Some of them I've downloaded now. My husband has taken up with me. He looks for those kind of things. Ah, this would be good for this lady at her age. This would be good for this guy at his age. Oh, this would be good in teaching them about human body and all that. I will do the downloading and all that. So when they get, they know that these are the tools, the games, the apps that we can use on the devices. And then there's some sites also. For instance, since I introduced them to code.org, it's fun, but they're learning also to build, and it has applications for all ages, from, like they say, from 0 to 104 years of age. So every child has, if she doesn't like this one, she can just browse through and find something else. And because it has their characters, their cartoon characters also in it, it's also more endearing for them. So yes, we don't just say, oh, they're wasting time playing games. You can't take it away from them, kind of, because they should actually have fun. But while having fun, can they, it's the same thing with screen time. What they watch on TV, I mean, you are just translating it to the digital world right now. So you can all
gather together, moms gather together. But a lot of your business takes place online, in the online space. Now, I'm sure you get to interact with a lot of moms who really don't have a clue about technology. So I guess, you know, everybody here, you know, is quite comfortable and has, you know, I guess a certain comfort, you know, with technology. But what if you are a mother or a father who just doesn't know? They don't know about filters. So if it was like, oh, to set up a filter, what is a filter? You know, talk less of how do I set it up, you know? They're so scared of their children, you know, being online that they just forbid anything to do with, you know, either using a phone or, you know, going on the internet. So for them, it's just about avoiding, ignoring that it's there. How do you start to, what do you start to say, you know, to advise, you know, these parents that, you know, these are the things you can do, these are the steps you can take, to a parent who is an absolute, like, techie novice?
So the extreme you had mentioned, I think it's very easy to be either of the two. Either you give your child everything they want, and from 5, 6, there's some children who have iPhones from really young ages, who have access to the internet, so that's one extreme. The other extreme is indeed parents who say, internet is dangerous and bad, so you can't be on it. And I think that's ostrich parenting. What does an ostrich do? It sticks his head in the ground. And so you can't avoid the fact that these things are real. And like Kemi mentioned, it's really about communication. The earlier you start talking to your children, because we don't have that much time. I say that now kids are exposed to external factors from, in fact, as soon as they are born, really, your phone is connected to the internet, TV is 24/7, you have domestic staff in your house. You don't know what they are doing online, you don't know what they are watching when they are with your child. Everybody's on WhatsApp. So really, if you think about it, your child is exposed from day one. So if you don't take the time to understand what my child is exposed to, you can't even parent in a relevant way. I know your child was talking about Nicki Minaj. This is not really technical, I mean technology. But the mother said, oh, who's Nicki Minaj? And the boy said, oh, it's just one new girl in my school. And the mother said, oh, really? When did she join? But the point being, if you allow your kids to think you don't know, they will run circles around you. So parents who are uncomfortable, you don't have to be a techie person, you don't have to love it. But it's the same thing with, I'll use a funny example. We can't say we know what breast milk tastes like. But you know it's good for your child. If you are working, you know you have to express, you have to keep it for your child, right? So I'm saying that sometimes you go out of your way to understand how to parent better based on what is happening today. Technology is real, it's here to stay. The only way we can save our children is to talk to them about it. Let them know that it's dangerous. There are many positive sides to it, but it's also very dangerous. My daughter was trying to search for pictures of minions, and as she typed in MI, all sorts of things started coming up. Simple minions. I mean, and I think I didn't set up Google Safe Search already. So these things, like you said, filter is great, but it's not the answer because they will always be bombarded by stuff that they need to in that moment. Say, oh my God, this is what mommy talked about. But this is what daddy had mentioned, that I shouldn't look at bad things. So they know not to look at it. So parents can, we can't avoid it. We can't run away from it. A lot of the content we put out, we try to talk about parenting in the digital age. So we talk about different tools you can download, different things you can turn on to help you, limit access, all those things. So it's like, parenting nowadays is just like you're constantly, you know, like a hamster in the, you're constantly running, catching up, different apps will come out. There's Tinder, where if I swipe to the right and you also swipe, we're automatically connected. And because of GPS, if I happen to be at Chateau Royale, I can say, oh hi, I see we're connected. Why don't we just meet across the road? So if you haven't had a conversation with a child, tell them that a stranger online is still a stranger, you know? So you're not always going to be there. So I really think, and I think that's one thing I see a lot. Mothers saying, I just don't get online. I just don't understand it. I just don't get that space, so I just ignore it. You really can't afford to ignore it. And the downside is too high. The danger is really, really, really too high. So we must just get comfortable.
So you run classes for parents, like Techie 101 or, I don't know, Social Media 101 for someone who doesn't have a clue.
As we are talking now, I thought actually that might be a good, actually something to do out of this is regular meetings to just say, let's talk about parenting in the digital space and what does it mean? You know, because I think we all take for granted the fact that we can turn on Google Search, I can create limits on computer usage, but many people are like, oh really? I didn't even know that existed. So it's a great idea.
Okay, great. So let's shift the discussion a little bit from the focus on how our children use technology to how we use technology. The buzz phrase or phenomenon right now is Internet of Things. You know, so how tools and apps are connected to each other, and you know, you can basically make your life, you know, so much easier. Are there tools or apps that you all use that helps to make not just your life easier, but in terms of parenting easier, whether that's keeping tabs with your children, organizing like a family calendar, or anything that you can share?
I use something called Any.do. I don't know if anybody has heard about it. But it's basically
Any.do.
It's a free app. And I downloaded it the other day when I was complaining about how I find it so difficult to keep track of everything. And basically it's a free personal assistant. In the morning, it'll say, good morning, Yeti. Do you want to plan your day? You know, do you want to follow up? Do you want, you know, so it's very intelligent. I don't know, maybe uses AI, I don't know, but basically it lets me drop anything that I want to remember. I put it onto that app and it reminds me that, hey, you put this here, do you want to deal with it now? And it also syncs with my Google Calendar. So it's a fantastic way to keep tabs on what I need to do. The other thing I use a lot is Google Calendar, actually. So I put a lot of things in there and I've synced it to my husband's calendar as well. So parent teacher conference, we both do it. So you can't forget, I'll put it in your calendar. So you do your meetings around it. So that has really helped help life for us. I think that's the new thing that has made life fantastic for me. Please download it.
Any.com.
Not the affiliate or anything. It's just.
That's good. I have it on the website, so I'm going to download that. So, what about you, Kelly?
Well, I guess basically it's maybe Google calendar, because I realized more for me and my husband, like you said, syncing. Because these days I have a lot of outside activities and sometimes, so I told you I was going there on Tuesday. It's not because I'm going, I just don't remember. So I have everything that I know and I think I know all out, and I said, please impute yours so that we can know that both of us are away for this period. We can make arrangements for the kids or whatever it is. So I think that's what I use most of the time. And then I OneNote also a lot to, like, my food list, my budgeting and all that. I'm the market, I don't need to make a list. I already have it on my phone. So I know what I've ticked out, what I need and all that. So it actually helps me.
Great.
I'm very straightforward. Calendar, Outlook calendar. And I like to know where everybody is all the time. I'm not OCD or anything. So WhatsApp, so we have a family room on WhatsApp. And, you know, we use that.
Okay, great. Prof,
okay, so we also use family WhatsApp. That's, you share common information, you can announce whatever is happening and also follow up. But I think one thing that's also very helpful, particularly for those that have young children, is use of devices in the vehicle that tells you where your vehicle is at any point in time. I mean, so maybe you are somebody who has a 4 or 5 year old that the driver needs to come pick from school, then it's good for you to have a device in that car that you can know where the car is at very particular point in time. I think it's very helpful, particularly when the children are very young, it will make a lot of difference. I also think that from the world of technology, we should start to also think about how technology can help us to be safe at home. So having smoke detectors at home will be helpful. Also having, the Bunsen burner, Bunsen burner is chemistry, the burner for your gas. You know, the smart gases today will not ignite till when there is a pressure on it of the port. So what that means is that if you remove the port and you forget to turn off the knob, it's go off itself. You know, so as we buy gadgets too, it's also good for us to start to think about those gadgets that use technology to keep us safe at the end of the day. Maybe things like alarms, things like basic things around thermometer, blood pressure measure, and also technology. But basically, allow me to just say something about the issue about how do you prevent the children. I think one thing we could also do is that I think the way we are buying computers in the house is also very helpful. So the general rule is that the computer screen must not face a wall. It must face everybody. So what that means is that nobody can watch somebody that is known that nobody can work on it. So the orientation of the screen is a very effective way. I think one thing that I've also seen to be very effective is when even you as a parent don't go there. I mean, if you don't go there, the power of personal example is very effective. And also the fact that you also occasionally allow your children to use your own gadget to browse. And you use their gadgets to browse. So what that means is that I can check your history, you can check my history. So I'm not just holding myself accountable, I'm also holding myself accountable. But you realize as parents that we have all these arrays of tools, depending on the age of our children, depending on the circumstance. And please, technology is not only about phones and gadgets. I mean, just having a good calendar that reminds you, even if it's written on the blackboard, it's technology one way or the other. But we need to start to use that to achieve our aims as parents at the end of the day.
Okay, do any of you have like cameras installed in your home so that maybe when you are in the office or out, you can actually monitor?
I was actually just going to raise that. What you said was spot on. In terms of things like nanny cam, these days you have access to your home on your phone and it doesn't actually see what is going on in your house if you have very young children. On tracking of younger children as well, there are options to keep them bracelets. There are options to have bracelets that can track them. So, I mean, it looks like a harmless bracelet. And you actually know where your kids are. So even when they're in the car with the driver or they're coming in with the domestic. So for young children, there are a lot of options now that people should really research and find out, you know, what works best for them.
Okay, that's wonderful. Thank you so much. I want to have some time for Q&A. So we're not just talking within ourselves. So I'd like to know if anyone has any questions. Please indicate with, you know, by raising your hand. Please just, you know, one question per person, you know, no parts A, B, C. And please go straight to the point, you know, no setting of context. So the hand I saw first was, I think, the lady over there. Is there a mic that she can have access to? Okay, someone is coming to you with a mic. Okay, so the lady in white.
My question is, having access to your child's password for Instagram, Facebook and everything, is it one of the appropriate measures in regulating your child's use of social media?
Okay, well, I'll just have one person answer that, so who would like to take that?
The password question is very important. What I've done in my home is try to downplay passwords. I've said to them, they shouldn't have passwords for internals. What I've done is not have passwords on my own stuff. But now, having access to password on their social media page, but only for my older one, I've never even wanted access to her password, so that has never come up. What I've done is, where possible, have long conversations that will put me in her life. So if I'm not a friend on that platform, or she doesn't tag me when she's doing stuff, I try to make sure I'm engaged enough that my values will extend into that space. I find that I'm certain that if I try to push to have a password for an 18-year-old, she's going to block me. And I don't even want to get to that conversation, because when they start protecting themselves from you, you're getting into dangerous territory. So I wouldn't ask my older kids for passwords.
Okay, that's a good point. All right, second, yes, okay, the gentleman in second row.
While growing up, we didn't have technology, but the whole aim was to basically secure the good life of the children, which you turned out to be. So technology came to basically help that. If this is what I'm saying, that once the aim is to be friends with your world, then the way you go about it, it's going to be different. In terms of trying to shield them from what's it called, the evil out there. Because while we were growing up too, there was the technology or the infrastructures that our parents used. Yes, they didn't have the technology that we have today, but they too had their own infrastructure and their own technology of trying to shield away or trying to make us become enemies with them. Because you see that some children turn out to be enemies with their parents, based on how their parents try to raise them. And at the same time, you have the ones that became good friends with their parents, despite the fact that they were trying to shoot them. So at the end of the day, I think what should be the focus should be about making your words your friends, so that they can actually connect with you, and you can always have that conversation from time to time.
Okay, thank you so much. That's a good point. So maybe not focusing so much on the tools, because the tools are always changing, but actually having a strong relationship with your children, where your values are passed on. Any questions from this side? Okay, we have someone over here.
Good afternoon, all. My name is Abiola. Just to put what he said, I think we try to monitor our children. Where do we put this stuff? Because we want to install the camera in the house, put the tracker in the car, check their online account and all that. Where do we put this stuff for that? Because sometimes, I was just going as an example, I like to be free. I don't like to be monitored. I don't like to be micromanaged, even at work presently. So where do we want to now do all that for our kids? How do stop to it, but where do we stop trying to manage them when it's over there?
Okay, you're an adult anyway, so for children, okay, so I guess the question is, where is the limits when you stop?
Well, I think the whole thing is really like you're a hawk watching over them, you care. And once they understand that why you are concerned about all these things is because you care, I don't think they will have issues with you. Children need monitoring. And they shouldn't be let on their own. At this stage, especially growing up stage, they need boundaries. We need to set for them boundaries. The truth is, I have to survive. If you insist on those boundaries, and they know you're doing it out of love, they will maintain your boundaries. And later, they'll be grateful that you did help them set those boundaries. It's all about the values we're talking about. So he's not having a tracker in his car because he wants to know where they're moving. I have a driver who should be picking my son by 2. Is that car at my son's premise by 2 o'clock? All that are born from the concern and the care you have for those kids. You know that, yes, online you have so many good things, but you also have so many bad things. And our children, yeah, they may be very, very techy, but that doesn't equate to digital literacy. There are so many things they don't know, they don't understand, they may not recognize. But being an adult, you can spot. For instance, somebody sends you a Facebook request. You look at the picture, you look at the name, you go through the history of the, you know, you go to the page. You can know if that is a real person or somebody who is just looking for something out there. You know, because you know, but oh, somebody from US is the time, you know, I sent a request and the kid is excited that he's having a request from me. So they need a level, and as a parent you know how far to go and how far to stop. Because every child is different, and every child requires different kind of strategy when dealing with them. Some children, you know that they are not very curious, inquisitive. You tell them to stay here, they stay there. Some, if you know stay here, you have to say to stay there 5 times before they actually stay. So for those ones, you know, you need to go the extra mile. So I believe that as parents, you know how to deal with their children, depending on them.
So there's a lady over here in yellow. She's looking back.
Thank you. My question is because this program is basically in Vegas. What about other people in other areas that may not really have access to this education right now? How do you actually reach out to them to actually let them know about how they can monitor their children or practically help them actually stay safe online? And plus, those in the rural area that their children actually have access to online activities, but they don't really know how to use this technology. So how do you go about that?